A very good morning once again. You are still watching the Rush Hour, and of course, as you very well know, we start at 6 and we go on up to 10 a.m. I am Agatha Mhaise, and I'm going to be taking you through the big issue, and of course, the issue we want to tackle today are the challenges that are being faced by the Banyaranda community in Uganda. And of course, here to talk about this is Simon Kaitana. He is the leader of the Banyaranda community, joined by his member of the community, that is Daniel Bayinza. A very good morning, gentlemen, and thank you for joining.
Actually, he's the coordinator of Banyaranda community in Greater Mitiana District.
Greater Mitiana District. Yes. Thank you for joining us, Daniel. Yes. Okay. I want to start off by first understanding the challenges. Simon, you are the leader of this community. What are these challenges that you're talking about?
We have several. Mm-hmm. One of it is denying Banyaranda their human rights of existence in this country. Mm-hmm. Two is that there are people, I don't know whether I could call them, who assume to be having powers over others who are denying Banyarwanda their existence mm-hmm. in this country. Mm-hmm. Who actually feel that Banyarwanda in this country, they are foreigners, they are not Ugandans.
Okay.
Forgetting about the existence of Uganda. Uganda was formed in 1962 mm-hmm. as a republic.
It got its independence in 1962.
Very good. As a republic of Uganda.
Yes.
We had kingdoms mm-hmm. which were under protectorate, British protectorate. And those kingdoms, actually, part of those kingdoms included one called Rwanda, the Great Rwanda, where we get even our identity. You see, in Buganda, they are Baganda.
Yes.
In Ankore, they are Banyankore. Mm-hmm. In Bunyoro, they are Banyoro. Toro mentioned them, even including Acholiland. Mm. Now, with these colonialists, when they were drawing borders, they did not follow any natural consideration of identifying who is a Munyarwanda, who is going to be a country called Uganda or belonging to a country called Rwanda.
Yes.
Given our economic activities, some of us, we are cattle keepers. We kept on migrating. Mm-hmm. Personally, I was born in Gomba. That is where I was born. And even my parents, my father.
Yes, was born.
But our great fathers, our great grandfathers are from Kabale. That is Kamwezi. They are still there. They speak Luchiga, they speak Runyarwanda. They are there. Kamwezi Gachuchu. That is in Uganda. They were cut off by borders. We have got Banyarwanda in Uganda, in Masaka. Mm-hmm. We have Banyarwanda in Namutamba, where he's coming from.
Okay.
We have Banyarwanda in eastern Uganda. There are even a place called Buchira. I have never reached there, in Busoga. Mm-hmm. Even in Busoga, we have Banyarwanda there.
Yes.
So, these Banyarwanda from those regions were not considered in 1995 constitution.
Why would you say they were not considered in the 1995 constitution, yet the same constitution recognizes Banyaranda as a tribe in this country?
Actually, it was listed as a tribe in Uganda constitution. But given the policy, given the considerations in relation to the policies which are being used by immigration, they were not considered. They are talking about 1926. Mm-hmm. That a Ugandan, Munyarwanda, to be considered a Ugandan, he must be a member of the indigenous community of 1926, of which 1926, one, we don't have any record talking about
Who was who? Who was where?
Who was who? Who was where? That is one thing. Two, 1926, it is not recorded anywhere in the classification of the tribes which were going to make Uganda. It was an event of drawing the last boundaries. Actually, I understand that they were now annexing the eastern Uganda onto the present day what? Uganda. Kisoro came in 1910. And you know very well that when you talk about the Kingdom of Rwanda,
yes,
it included the Ndorwa, Mpororo, it included Kisoro. All those places had Banyarwanda.
And the Kingdom of Rwanda before
before the demarcation. Yeah. I want actually to explain this very serious to even the listeners that Banyarwanda are not foreigners as they may think. We are not foreigners. We were cut off by the colonialist. Even when they talk about 1926, the so-called territory, the protectorate, which they are talking about, it was managed by a company of Imperial British East African Company.
Yeah.
It was not Uganda by then.
So I'm going to come back to you, Simon. I want to first come to Daniel, and I see his point of view. He says that Banyarwanda are not enjoying human rights.
Yes.
And they are not foreigners.
Yeah.
I want to hear from you. What are the challenges that the Banyarwanda community is facing in Uganda?
Yes, thank you very much. Actually, Banyarwanda community in Uganda, as has been saying, there is a root cause of not enjoying their benefits or their rights as a Banyarwanda.
Mm.
As has been saying in the Constitution of Uganda, 1962, it was stating very well, and all the people who are born in Uganda by 8th October 1962,
yes,
they are supposed to be Ugandans.
Yes.
And now when we come to the Constitution of 1995, it goes back then to 1926.
Yes.
Your great-grandparents should have been here, mm-hmm, one of the indigenous communities in Uganda,
mm,
in 1926.
Mm.
So there is a contradiction between this Constitution of 1962, mm, and 1995.
Yes.
So when the Banyarwanda go like acquiring some documents, like passport, that they look at you and say, your names, because we have names of Banyarwanda, and maybe the look, I don't know, because everyone can look like the other.
Yes.
But sometimes they look at you and say, you are Banyarwanda, and according to your name. So they say, can you clarify yourself? Can you prove beyond reasonable doubt?
So they use visual aid to say you're this.
Exactly, exactly. They look at you like you now. When you go to internal affairs, they look at you because the way you look, you are as if you're a Munyarwanda. So they start to ask you. And you have to prove without the reasonable doubt that your great grandfathers, they were here in 1926. And whereby there is no anyhow you can prove that one. There's no records. Even in internal affairs, they don't have the records about 1926,
yes,
people were here. And now, there you fail to prove how your parents were here or the grandfathers that you are here in 1926. Mm. And yet, we are listed in the Constitution of Uganda, 1995. And then when you say, I was born in Uganda, and then you prove you have an ID,
mm-hmm,
you studied from here, you have all the documents, you can show that you have been here, you are born of Uganda. But they continue even to say, please, continue to prove that your grandparents were here. And maybe they are died. They are not there. Even if they are there, who is now alive who was in 1926? That you can go and ask and maybe they come and prove. There's no way how. So that's how the Banyarwanda are suffering.
So your issue is, if yes, I may quote you right, is right, you feel discriminated,
yes,
by the immigration's office.
Exactly. Exactly.
But these are challenges that many other people face, not only Banyarwanda.
Particularly Banyarwanda, because for us, they ask us many questions as far as 1926 is concerned.
Yes.
And nobody whom I have ever heard of in any other tribe, they ask, prove your grandparents in 1926. I have never heard any of them. If you have ever had one, that's good. But I have never had any of those who have been asked such questions. It's only Banyarwanda who are asked the questions. And after that, they say, go back to Rwanda to get the documents. You are not a Ugandan. And yet I was born here. And now I have an ID. I studied from here. I have all the good documents. And even you have the gratuity tax for our fathers, for our grandparents. But even if you prove them, you bring them here, they don't even accept. They say, you are a Munyarwanda. So that's how Banyarwanda are tortured or are harassed in the internal affairs. They cannot go and get like others.
Do you have evidence of these people that have been harassed, as you call it?
So many of them.
I want to come back to you, Simon. What have you done about this discrimination?
Actually, we have had so many meetings, including with the highest office of the president, with the Minister of Internal Affairs. This is the evidence. The meeting which we had with the Minister of Internal Affairs.
I'm saying Minister of Internal Affairs, this is the agenda of the meeting that was had on November 2008.
Yes, that was out of so many national IDs, passports, which had been confiscated from our community.
Yes.
How many?
Actually, we had about 25,000.
By then.
In 2018.
Yes.
The day we met the president, we presented everything, even including a lot of humiliation against Banyarwanda. Mm-hmm. And he appointed one of his AD to make a follow-up. That is where that meeting was emanating from. And of course, even up to now, those people have never got their freedom. Their IDs are still
confiscated.
Actually blocked, not confiscated. They were confiscated from the border, but they are now blocked. Even if you say that you're going to make a replacement, those IDs are blocked.
When you go to NIRA, they are blocked.
Yes, when you go to NIRA, they are blocked. We had a meeting with the permanent secretary. Who was called Ben, I don't know another name. We had, of course, the NIRA people, the directors and others were present, even immigration, to try and sort out that problem.
So let's first talk about this Rwanda community, first of all. Who appointed you people to be the leaders of the Rwanda community in Uganda?
Right. So as a community, we come together because we are a community, recognized community in Uganda.
Yes.
In the constitution of Uganda. So we have a freedom of assembly. So the Banyarwanda organized themselves, or we organized ourselves, and we decided to choose leaders among ourselves. Okay. So that we can work on not only on this issue, but other issues as a community. So that's how we came up with this association, the Ugandan Banyarwanda Association. Then we elected the leaders, and one of them is here,
yes,
our chairman. So that's how we came up with electing leaders, so that we can solve some problems. Not only this, but even among ourselves, if there is any problem or any question or what, or like that, that's how we came up with an association. Yes.
So who do you represent in particular? Is it all the Banyarwanda
all
in Uganda, or also the foreigners who are actually born and bred in Rwanda but live here?
All Banyarwanda in Uganda. All Banyarwanda born in Uganda and who are Ugandan. You see, culture does not have boundaries. Of course, when we talk about our culture, you see, people are confusing two things. Being a Ugandan, it has to be legal.
Yes.
The nationality, it can be extraterritorial.
Explain that extraterritorial.
Very good. that Banyarwanda can be in Uganda, even in another country, Congo, Rwanda, Tanzania, and other, and another country. Mm-hmm. But when
as foreigners or as people that were born
in those countries,
because from my understanding, is what makes you a citizen of a country.
Actually, that's what we are talking about now, the legality of Banyarwanda in this country. When you talk about Banyarwanda in Rwanda, of course we are less concerned about that business of Banyarwanda in Rwanda. Talk about Banyarwanda in Congo, in Tanzania, that is their business. It is not even, you know, an isolated case in Uganda. We have even people who are in Uganda along Kenya borders.
Yes, who are Luo.
Yes, very good. Even those Samias. You remember the time when we had the minister here of IT and the vice president the other side.
Mm-hmm.
That is Agra Ori and Munda Ori in Kenya.
Yes.
So for us, we are Banyarwanda of Rwandan origin, as I explained, that we originate from that kingdom because of the colonial considerations.
Yes.
And actually, I want to mention something very important, that Banyarwanda, according to the history of Uganda, before Uganda was named Uganda, even in 1910, when they were making the first statistics, Banyarwanda was listed as an indigenous what? Among the population of the people who are going to make, who are going to form the present day Uganda. In 1926, when they were drawing the last boundaries, Banyarwanda, they had a reasonable number. And even beyond that, we had even these people who came in Uganda on contractual considerations. For example, people from Masaka, Namutamba, where he comes from, and other things. These guys, the colonialists, when they were considering now a Republic of Uganda, the constitution, now a draft which was presented in Lancaster of London, which was now going to classify who is going to be a Ugandan and who is not going to be a Ugandan. For us, we feel that Banyarwanda were considered, because they say that whoever was in Uganda on
8th October 1962
is going to be a what? A citizen of this country.
Yes.
Whatever was done by some, actually, people, some politicians who are selfish, considering those things of succession, they excluded Banyarwanda intentionally, because in 1980s, 82 up to 86, Banyarwanda had considerable contribution towards the liberation of this country.
Yes.
As Banyarwanda,
actually, we had more than
60. As Banyarwanda, the citizens of Uganda, or Banyarwanda, the neighbors.
Actually, we had even Banyarwanda who were by then refugees, but even the citizens. And in 1995, some people thought that the succession is going to be
prolonged.
Is going to be actually in that line that Banyarwanda, much as we are here, these people have contributed a lot. The only way how we can exclude them from
succeeding
in terms of, you know, being appointed as ministers, prime ministers, vice president, it's by actually creating that clause of 1995 clause of Banyarwanda proving that you must be among the indigenous community of 1926, because in 1926 there is no event which is known on record.
Simon,
yes,
very many Banyarwanda citizens of Uganda have made it to top offices in this country, politically, even in the Luchiko of Buganda. We very well know this.
Personally, I represent Banyarwanda and Luchiko. Actually, yes. we actually thank the Kabaka of Buganda.
I can see you wearing a breast.
Yeah, sure.
I'm sorry for your loss. But why would you say that they specifically did this to avoid that succession, yet Banyarwanda have made it to some of these top offices?
Which office? Can you mention about those political offices where one can say that I'm a Banyarwanda and stand boldly the way we are saying that we are Banyarwanda in broad daylight, even in cameras, saying that I'm a Banyarwanda and I can even speak Banyarwanda when I'm with the kings?
So you're saying they do it stealthily?
Actually, you see, some people have been using Banyarwanda as a tool for survival.
How is that so?
Some people who actually call themselves Banyarwanda, when you even dig it into their description of passports and even identification, they are called Bahororo. They are not Banyarwanda.
They are Bahororo.
They say, for us, we are Bahororo. You can check in the records. In fact, there has been a duping of Banyarwanda by some of those people trying to even confuse Banyarwanda that everything is okay. By, you know, speaking a language is a different thing.
Yes.
And standing for the right cause is another one. Banyarwanda in Uganda, the reason why we have these problems is because some people are hiding in that what?
Yes.
They are hiding behind sort of like a wolf skin.
Yes, very good. When we talk about Banyarwanda, who are the Banyarwanda? These are people who can stand and speak Kinyarwanda in a broad daylight, the way I do, and even him. The people who can stand against humiliations, against Banyarwanda. The people who can defend Banyarwanda when their properties are being taken away from them. The people who are proud to even say, I'm a Banyarwanda in a broad daylight and even at night.
Simon, I'm going to come back to that discrimination and of course harassment that you're talking about of Banyarwanda right after this break. We are talking about the challenges of Banyarwanda, and of course I'm sitting with the leader and of course also coordinator of the Banyarwanda community. We'll be right back. Welcome back from that break. I'm Agatha Mhais, and of course I'm still taking you through the big issue where we are talking about the challenges that are being faced by the Banyarwanda community in Uganda. So these people are people that are born and bred in this country. So they are supposed to be citizens because they are a recognized tribe in Uganda. However, they say they are facing challenges, especially at immigrations, whereby they claim their passports and national IDs are confiscated, requiring them to give evidence that they are actually citizens of this country. I am, of course, still sitting with the leader of the Banyarwanda community, that is Simon Kaitana, and of course, the coordinator of
Greater Mubende.
Of Greater Mubende, that is Daniel Buyinza. And later on phone, I'm going to be joined by the spokesperson of immigrations, that is Simon Mundei. We were still talking about the discrimination that you face. Before I get into the discrimination, I want to bring in Daniel here.
Yes.
I hear there was a change in name from Banyarwanda to Bavandemwe. What caused that? What is happening around there?
For us, we are not advocating for that change of the name.
You as the association?
Yeah, yes. For our association, because we don't belong to those people who wanted to change the name. And by the way, I think they thought if they change the name from Banyarwanda to Bavandimwe, maybe it might help. But actually for us, we cannot change our name. because we are Banyarwanda and we are already in the constitution. Why should we change our name? We are Banyarwanda. So for us, we are not advocating for changing the name.
Well, yes. Thank you very much, Daniel. I'm going to stop you there because Simon Munde, the immigration spokesperson, is joining us on phone right now. A very good morning, Simon, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Urban TV, and thanks for having me this morning.
Yes, we are talking about the challenges being faced by the Banyarwanda community. And one of the challenges they say they are facing is at the immigration office, where they claim their passports are confiscated because they cannot prove, or you want them to prove, that they are Ugandans. Are you aware of this?
Thank you. It is true. Some of our brothers from that community have been having some issues at the passport office. Some of them, not all. Because I will clarify and explain as follows. One, the immigration staff here have no problem with our sisters and the brothers from the other community. As you know, these are our people. These are people who were born here, raised here, went to school here, have done everything here. They actually do not know anything the other side of Rwanda.
Yes.
We know this. They speak very good Luganda, Lusoga. Some of them speak even my language.
Yes.
So we also get issues. Now, these are our people. Why do we really question their citizenship? Mm-hmm. But the problem that ties both of us, that community and us, is the law. We have a problem with the law. The law says whoever is born here to non-Ugandans, the father and the mother being a non-Ugandan, is treated as a foreigner. Mm-hmm. For instance, if the father is a Rwandese, maybe somebody who came from Rwanda, came to Uganda, settled here, and the mother also from the same community came here, settled here, they produced children, and those children are treated as foreigners. It pains us as immigration, because these are our people. We have gone to school with them, we have done literally everything with them.
Yes.
So, but the law says, The Banyarwanda in the constitution, in the third schedule of the constitution, recognizes only those Rwandese, Ugandans of Rwandese origin,
yes,
who were found here during the demarcation process of 1926,
yes,
when they were demarcating the boundaries of Rwanda and then Uganda. Now, those who were found in Uganda were treated as Ugandans of Rwandese origin and hence put in the constitution as Banyarwanda tribe. Now, the other, it is very difficult and cumbersome for an immigration officer to ask somebody who was born in 1990, for instance, 2000, and you ask such a person to prove that you actually, your ancestors, your jaja, or your grandmother, great-great-grandfather,
yes,
originated from Rwanda, but came to Uganda in 1926, February, or before that. It's very, very difficult. So the only advice I give my sisters and brothers, we are with them, and I will support them, and the Minister of Internal Affairs supports them in lobbying either Parliament of the Republic of Uganda to change that law,
Simon,
so that whoever is born here can be treated as a citizen of Uganda, like it is in other countries like US, like Canada. Because when you go to Canada and produce children there, whoever is born there is automatically a citizen of that place. But
Simon,
here, the law ties us.
You're talking about them lobbying the different leaders to have this averted in the law. But my question to you as one of the heads of immigrations would be, have you done anything on your part? Because these people believe that the people that were recognized as citizens of Uganda are people that were around before 8th October 1962, when Uganda got independence. However, you require them to have documents that prove their origin from 1926. The gentleman I'm sitting here with have told me a third generation Ugandans. Have you done anything in your office to solve this?
Yeah, we have also not just seated cross-legged here in the ministry. Because of these challenges we have been having time and again, we have made proposals. And what I have just told you is a proposal we made to Parliament. So we have not just sat. That proposal, we already sat. It is, committees are already sitting. As I talk, we are moving around, gathering views. We shall even approach those people. So it is very erroneous of our brothers and sisters to keep blaming immigration, to keep blaming Minister of Internal Affairs.
The but you're the ones that confiscate their passports and national IDs.
Yeah, some cases have happened, which is unfortunate. But like I told you, it is all according to that archaic law, if I should call it.
Yes.
But all these can be reversed if these days they call them the name Bavandimwe.
Bavandimwe, yes.
If they can come, sit together with us, we lobby as a group, as a strong group, to Parliament of Uganda, because proposals have already been made. Our legal department has sat down, has drafted all of this I'm talking about. They're already in writing, and we just need their support, and this thing would be sorted. Otherwise, the issue of bashing immigration, the issue of bashing internal affairs, the issue of going to meetings and actually abusing immigration staff for being insensitive, for being very crude in the way they are doing their work, will not solve this problem. Because for them, they are actually following the law in place. So let us come together as brothers and sisters, because we are the same. Definitely we are the same, and their cries are our cries. We do not feel good when these people come cry here. Last week, there was a girl who came. The father came from Rwanda in 1972.
Yes.
And the mother, they came, they relocated to Uganda. These children were born here in 1994, 95, 96. There are three of them in the family. Now, it so happened that the parents also died from here. Now, these children have never left Uganda. They know Uganda because they have been in Zimbabwe all their time. They have their land there. They have tilled the ground there. Everything is Ugandan. I felt very bad to actually question their citizenship. But because the law says so, who am I to go against it?
But then how come, if immigration is following the law, how come they have national IDs, meaning the national national identity registration authority is actually recognizing them as citizens? What makes it different when they come to your office?
Now, the issue of not whoever holds the national ID is a citizen, which is supposed to be like that ordinarily. But there were issues. I remember when we started the registering for national ID, we did not have an national data bank where we were referring, where we were getting info. During that time, I remember I was in charge of Karamoja to try to talk to the public to come and register for national ID. We started from scrap. There was nothing.
Yes.
That was the time of Minister Late Aronda Nyakairima. So he appointed us, we moved around, we were just pleading to people. So whoever came to register for national ID was actually given. They never asked the questions. People came, registered, said, I am Ugandan, they registered them. That is why We even had some Indians. We even had Chinese. We even had people who wanted, whoever wanted to get a national ID at that time actually got a national ID. Now, the story changed. You cannot just go now and pick a national ID like it was before. Because that time, I remember when I went to Karamojo on radio to try to sensitize that group, people were calling in radio and abusing us. They say, no, you are registering us. You want to take our land. You want to take our cattle. This were Karamojongs. Mm. We are just pleading to whoever would come would say, okay, thank you, God, for bringing this one. And people are registered. Now we are trying to correct that record. That is why you see now there is a mass enrollment of national ID, and those mistakes are being corrected. The story has changed now. So it is true there are some of those people who have genuine national IDs.
Mm.
But when they come here to verify citizenship, they get issues, and those IDs are confiscated because they were given in error, first of all. And yes. It was like people were doing a favor to government to volunteer to come and register. We did not have a national bank, data bank. Right now, we have it, and they are now very careful in trying to register and issuing IDs.
Mr. Simon, right before now. I let you go, Kaita Nahia has a question for you. Yep. You were saying, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mundey. I appreciate the lacuna in the law, and actually that's what we are addressing, that there has to be a bill which is going to be rectifying all those mistakes.
Yes, sir.
But before that, which law do you use to confiscate one's ID in a transit?
You see, for us as immigration, we register citizens. We verify citizenship. Now, for instance, the IDs we have been withdrawing and confiscating are from people. We have been very careful about this, by the way. Some people come here requesting for passports, and in the process of interrogating them, they willingly pull out IDs of other countries. We have seen people here with IDs of Kenya and Uganda. That one we have to withdraw ours because we are the authority that issued that document. We have powers over that document. It is like when we issue a passport in error and there is an issue on it, we have those powers in the Act, in the Immigration Act, to withdraw that ours we issue. We do not have powers to withdraw a document issued by another state.
Yeah.
Most of the IDs we have confiscated, by the way, if you come here, you will find that we confiscated because we found a person with two national IDs. One of Rwanda, another one of Uganda. Then
and
we say,
have
now,
proof
who are
of
you?
This.
Are you a Rwandese? Are you a Ugandan?
You have
two national IDs.
You have proof of people with two national IDs.
Please, we do. And these are the things I've been talking about. I remember one time I talked about this issue. Even I showed the press. Some of the IDs. Somebody has one of Kenya, one of Uganda. Those are mainly the ones who have been confiscating. Now, these other ones, we haven't been confiscating. We tell the person now, leave the ID as we carry out investigation.
Mm.
Some of them have not been confiscated per se, but it has been that we are keeping it in the hands of government, which issued the same document anyway, as we continue with the investigation. Who else will keep it?
That is very true. Thank you very much, Simon Mundey, for making the time for us today.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Well, that was Simon Mundey. He is the spokesperson of Immigrations. So, gentlemen, you have heard what the side you are accusing has to say. What are your thoughts, Simon?
Actually, you see, for me, I don't blame him when he talks about the law.
Hmm.
And actually, that's what we are proposing, that we have a bill which is going to do identification and management of Banyarwanda and other roving communities.
Yeah.
We are not being you know, specific on Banyarwanda, but there might be other Ugandans who are going through what we are going through,
yes,
in terms of citizenship, you know, registration. But what I don't actually recommend from the immigration is that sometimes they withdraw national IDs for their personal consideration, either by looking at you, and even some people might have even personal vendetta against others.
You have proof of this as well?
Yes, we do.
Where somebody has been looked at, identified as a Mnyarwanda.
Actually, before even going through the application process,
yes,
an immigration officer says, for you cannot get an ID, you are Mnyarwanda.
Yeah.
Those testimonies were in our consultative meetings at Sheraton. Mm-hmm. The meetings which you had at Sheraton, you had that young boy, someone saying that for you, with the look, you cannot be a Ugandan. Two, I think as an organization of immigration, for us we are Ugandans. Mm-hmm. By the way, we are not even seeking anyone's permission to be one. We are Ugandans and we believe we are Ugandans. No one can deny us
your right to be
our rights to be one.
Yes. I want to bring in Daniel here. How best do you think the government can differentiate between Banyarwanda born and bred in Uganda and those that are from Rwanda?
Yeah, actually, the way to differentiate people is by documents. That's the only way. You cannot differentiate people by looking at them. That's a mistake they do in immigration, actually. Though it's mentioning such, but we have many evidences where the people, they go to immigration, our community, and they are looked at and say, the way you look, and actually it's terrible there, because they if the ladies, they go there, you know, the ladies, they wear the structure, they wear, they look, you raise up, and they raise up, and they say, you're definitely Mnyarwanda. So that's not the way. I think the way to differentiate people from Rwanda and people of the Rwanda in Uganda is by documentation, is by LOCs, is by local councils. Because this Banyarwanda, they live in the community in Uganda.
Hmm.
There is LOC system, there is RDS system, there is everything, and the security organs. They can prove that so and so is from here. And by proving that, there's a documentation which should be presented, either by the authorities or by a person himself or herself, that I'm a born of Uganda, I'm a Ugandan, this is my document. And this is the document from the local authorities. So that's how they can differentiate or discern between the Banyarwanda of Uganda and the Banyarwanda of Rwanda.
Actually, an addition to that, citizenship is illegal.
Yes.
Not by ethnicity. Ethnicity can go even across.
Yes.
That is what the Mundis and others are using to now identify who is a Ugandan and who is not. The bill we are bringing today, it is to solve that problem. It's to address that problem of identification, certification, dignity, management, and protection of Banyarwanda community. That is the bill we are
the
putting
issue
forward.
That you're trying to solve.
Yes, that is the solution of all this. Of people not actually using their feelings,
or their eyes,
even their thinking. You have a right to say that I don't like that person, but you must respect me. You understand? As a Ugandan. So, the bill we are bringing now, it is to actually solve that problem.
One last question, of course, and I would like to conclude this, Simon. One last question. Beyond this meeting that you try to have with Internal Affairs and, of course, the President of Uganda, what else as an organization have you done to address these issues?
Actually, you see, when there is a problem of course people will raise their issues and even the solutions. One, some people proposed what you said of changing our identity or changing the name of our community or of our tribe. We said no. Our tribe has a history in Uganda which cannot be erased. Even you heard what he was saying Monday. I want to put this right, that Banyarwanda, we are very proud of being who we are.
Yes.
At all costs. Whether you subject us under whatever conditions, we can never change our identity, we can never change our name of our community.
So when you rejected because changing the name, what else did you do?
We said we are not party to the group which is proposing the changing of the name. Because it is very, it is artificial, unreasonable, coarse, and even inconsiderate.
Mm-hmm.
Because Banyarwanda, we have a history in our culture and values to protect, which must be respected by whoever thinks otherwise.
Mr. Kaitana.
Yes.
So you had a meeting that you did not much was yielded, according to you. This idea of changing names was very unwelcome because you have a culture to protect.
Yes.
Have you done anything else?
Actually, the reason why we are bringing this bill,
yes,
it is against that background that we feel that Banyarwanda should not forget about their culture, but follow the law. As I said, that citizenship is illegal. There has to be a law which can identify us as citizens of Uganda. Not in any other way of convincing our community members to change or get assimilated to other
tribes
for the survival.
Oh.
One, for me to be a Munyarwanda, it is actually a blessing from God, the one who created me, to give me that identity. So I don't feel that any person should come up and say, if you want ABCD, you should change your culture, you should change your identity.
Yes, but when you talk about Banyarwanda have lived peacefully and traveled comfortably in Uganda, how are they be able to do that?
Actually, as we talk now, we have Banyarwanda who are stuck in foreign countries like Abu Dhabi. Initially, they were misled to change their tribe and even ethnicity to say that for us, we are Banyankore. Others said they are Baganda. Now, in the verification process, as he mentioned, they are saying, you guy, you said you were Munyankore. Your father is called Kaitana. Kaitana, they are not Banyankore, they are Banyarwanda. Your father is Nkurunziza. In Banyankore, we don't have Nkurunziza. So, the only thing you have to do is to come back from wherever you are, in Abu Dhabi, in UK, in wherever, you need to go back to Uganda apply citizenship by naturalization. Actually,
so you're saying the people that are surviving, Banyarwanda who are surviving comfortably in Uganda, have to go away with lies to change who they are.
Actually, majority of them.
Thank you very much, Simon. Thank you very much, Daniel, for making the time. Unfortunately, that is all the time we had for the big issue. Thank you for watching. However, don't go away. Miles Ramiti is coming with the campaigner in a university here in Central Uganda that has caught fire on the streets. We'll be right back.